All right, guys, we are still on practice test number 2 for math practice for your CLT exam that's coming up. My first question to you now on part 2, how are you doing on your timer? You see your timer coming down here. If you've been working on these questions and you're getting close to the end, then I want you to not go through this video right now, but finish looking at practice test number 2 and use up your time and submit your test and see how many questions you get right before you move forward with practicing with me. And then I want you to submit your test at the bottom when your timer's up, and then you can come back in to the test with me again, do your letter of the day, put in the answer choices that you know for sure were correct from last time, and then meet me back here on question number 85 to go through some questions with me. So this is test 2, part 2. We're starting on question number 85. It says line Q is perpendicular to Y equals 2X. Y equals negative 2x plus 6 and contains the point 4, 3. What is the x-intercept of line Q? Okay, I'm going to start with graphing this point 4, 3 in the coordinate plane. I got my x-axis and my y-axis. And the 4 is telling me to go right by 4. And the 3 is telling me to go up 3. So I know this point here at 4, 3 is on line Q. And we want to see where this line, however it goes, touches the x-axis. And now the next piece of information we know about line Q is what they told us first, is that it's perpendicular to y equals negative 2x plus 6. So when it's perpendicular, what's important about this is the slope. And which part of this equation is the slope? It's going to be the negative 2. And when I'm thinking about slope, I want to think about it as a fraction. So any whole number, to make it to a fraction, you just put a 1 at the bottom. And I want the perpendicular slope. And the rule for a perpendicular slope is that it's going to be two things different from here to here. The perpendicular slope is going to be upside down. So instead of 2 over 1, is 1 over 2, and opposite. So instead of being negative, it's going to be positive. And that's telling me from my point, I would go up 1 over 2. So from here, I go up 1 over 2. And that's going to take me off in this direction over here. But I want to find the x-intercept for my answer. So I need to know, where does this line touch my x-axis? And I can kind of eyeball it and say, oh, I think it's going to be negative 2 because it looks like it's going to go past all of those positive numbers. And then we can just prove it by using our slope. So from this point, we're going to go down 1 and back 2. Then we're going to go back 1 again. Down 1 again, I'm sorry, and then back 2, and then we go down 1 and back 2. So our x-intercept would be here at negative 2, so that was correct. And next we've got question number 86. For a triangle with two angles measuring 45 degrees, which of the following must be false. So I'm going to draw my triangle with two angles measuring 45 degrees. And that's pretty close. We'll label that 45 degrees, and that one's 45 degrees, and they're the same. It is a right triangle. Is that true or false? My three angles inside of my triangle have to add up to how much? The three angles have to add up to 180 degrees. And we got a 45 and a 45. And 45 plus 45 makes 90. And this 90 plus how much more makes 180. So my last angle would be another 90 degree angle. So that's actually true. We got a right angle in our triangle, so that's a right triangle. The two legs of the triangle are equal in length. If that angle's 45, then this is a certain length. And if this angle's 45, it matches the length of the other one. So the two legs are equal in length. That's true. The hypotenuse of the triangle is longer than its two sides. The hypotenuse, yes, that's always true. It's always longer than the sides because it's across from the biggest angle. So the last one must be false. All three angles in the triangle are acute. Nope. Only two of them are. The 90 degree angle is not an acute angle. It's a right angle. And number 87. By now we've seen quite a few practice questions that look kind of similar to this, where they're giving us some symbol and we don't really like, oh, I don't know what that symbol means. Well, that's okay. We don't need to know. It's just a symbol. I'm going to call it a circle. If circle is defined such that P circle Q equals P cubed over Q plus 5, then which of the following is equivalent to 3 circle 9? So from what we've had in class, right? We're going to say, okay, we're going to take our P cubed over Q plus 5. And I want to sub in numbers for my variables because all of the answer choices have a number. So where I see the P, it's in front of the circle. So what's going to make sense to sub in for the P? Going to look back here, and P is in front of the circle, and the 3 is in front of the circle. So I'm going to sub a 3 for the P. And now for the Q, it's behind the circle, as well as what number? The 9 is behind the circle. So for the Q, I'm going to sub a 9. And now we have all numbers, so we can simplify this to find the answer. And, okay, moving forward, 3 cubed means 3 times 3 times 3, right? 3 times 3 is 9, times 3 again is 27 over 9 plus 5. And 27 over 9, that's a fraction. Every fraction is what kind of question? Every fraction is a division question. And 27 divided by 9 is 3. So I'm going to erase that. Change it to a 3. And now we've got our answer. 3 plus 5 is, you got it, 8. All right. And, okay, good. Still got 5 minutes. Number 88 says, if W is an even integer, then which of the following is odd? What is an even integer? What does that mean? Just like, what's an easy even integer I can plug in for W? What's the easiest even integer you can think of? I hope you're thinking of the same one as me. I'm just thinking of 2. So anywhere I see a W, I'm going to sum in a 2 because 2 is an even number, that, and it's an integer. So 2. 25 times 2. Not odd. 2 to the power of 3 is 248. Not odd. 2 to the power of 5 minus 1. 248, we already said. 8 times 2, 16 times 2, 32. 32 minus 1, 31. We found our odd. Whenever you multiply a number times an even number, you're going to get the product to be an even number. Or if you add an even number to an even number, or subtract an even number from an even number, you're going to get an even number. But if you have an even number and you add or subtract an odd number, you'll get an odd. So knowing that will help you get those questions a little bit faster. And I think I can get, I can get the next one in before my time's up. Number 89, which of the following is equivalent to the absolute value of 3x minus 5 is greater than 7? I think this time, rather than plug and check or guess and check, I'm going to do the algebra way here. I'm going to split this off into 2 inequalities for the app to get rid of the absolute value. So if you need to brush up the rules on this, this type of question is an absolute value inequality. Q-U-A-L-I-T-Y. So my rules for absolute value inequalities says that I'm going to split this off, and the first time it's going to look just like this. Since the absolute value is isolated on this side, it's going to look just like this without the absolute value. 3x minus 5 is greater than 7. And then we got our and or the next side. I'm going to leave my stuff that was inside the absolute value, 3x minus 5. And instead of 7, I'm going to make it negative 7. And I always remember that whenever I bring a negative into the inequality party, something happens to the inequality and it's going to flip around. So instead of being greater than on this side, it's going to be less than. And now I can continue solving for x on both of these. And my first step solving for x on both is to get rid of a minus 5. How do you get rid of a minus 5? You're going to add it on both sides of the inequality. And then start simplifying. And that's going to give us 3x is greater than 7 plus 5 is 12 because those guys canceled. And on the other side, we got 3x cancel is less than negative 7 plus 5. Signs are opposite, so you can subtract them. 7 minus 5 is 2, but it needs to be negative because my negative number was bigger than a positive. And then last step. Now that we've got rid of the 5, we want to get rid of the 3 to get the x by itself. The 3 and the x are doing what together? They're multiplying. How do you get rid of multiplication when you're solving for x? You divide out whatever's multiplying with your x. So we're dividing everything by 3. So we can cancel out our 3s, which is going to give us that x is greater than 12 divided by 3 is equal to 4. X is greater than 4. This says x is greater than 4. That does not. Not. X less than 4. Not. So B has to be our correct answer.